Unselfishly died on Calvary. Oh, how you gave your life for me. Bruised, scorned, crowned your head with thorns. No greater love performed for me. Nailed in your hands, nailed in your feet. Pierced in your side, could barely breathe. Could have gained down, yet you remain standing in awe of the price you paid. I never knew of a love so true. You gave your life and still I hurt you. Lost so many times, crucified you again. But I repent, forgive me for my sin. You played it all up on the cross. You bled and died, cause I was lost. So here I am, surrendering all. Lord, hear my cry. On my knees I fall. You paid it all. Oh, oh, you paid it all. Oh. In exchange for the blood you shed for my sins.
Your life. a man in this who died for me.
Thank you. Amen. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. The tomb is empty, and darkness has lost and can no longer grip our souls. No more do we have to fear, because we can dance in the light of Jesus' resurrection. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. Good morning, Hartford, and welcome to our Easter Sunday service. Whether you're in the sanctuary or streaming online or another electronic device, we're thankful and grateful that you have joined us. Please stand with me and sing our opening song, Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Thank you.
all-powerful and loving God, your joy floods our souls because Jesus the Christ is risen today. Open our hearts to receive your joy in songs and your preached word, an amazing hope for the future, that we will know that beyond a shadow of a doubt, that you live because you live in us. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen. Please remain standing for the scripture reading taken from John, the 20th chapter, the 1st through the 18th verses, and I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, and he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. And now we will receive our anthem from our choir.
Thank you.
truly risen today. Thank you, combined choirs, Dr. Sylvia Hollifield on the organ, Julian Good on the drums, Felicia Hill. Amen, amen. It is prayer time, saints. The Lord says, comfort ye my people. And as the deacons come to pass out sick visitation cards, I ask you to stand if you'd like to remember someone who's special, who's sick and shut in, a family that's grieving, and certainly someone who is troubled in mind, body, or spirit. As we go to the throne of grace with Reverend Carrie Foster, amen.
Good morning. Happy Resurrection Sunday to all of you all. This is our prayer time. If you want to stand for prayer, you can. Let us all go to the house of prayer. Dear most holy, heavenly, eternal, loving Savior God, we come here this morning to worship you, O Lord. We come here to worship you on this Resurrection Sunday. Because Jesus, you got up from the grave and you had all victory in your hands, that you defeated death, that death is not no more. You was raised from the dead. God raised you from the dead. And we come here this morning to give you all the praise and the honor for dying for us, for our sins, from our iniquities, from our principality, our wrongdoing, that you died, but you did not stay dead. You got up this morning, and we come here to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. That Jesus, that you are our Savior, our King, our Lord, our Mother, our Father. You are our God. And we come here to give you the praise, the honor, the thanks, and the glory this morning. Lord, come by here at Hartford and touch every last soul that represented here today. Touch the people that is watching online. Touch the people from the hospital bed. That Jesus, that you are a healer. You are a wonderful counselor. You are a matchless God. Nothing could fail from you, oh God. Nothing could fail. Touch us, oh God, when we go through heartaches, when we go through depression, when we go through sadness, when we lost loved ones. Touch families that have lost loved ones, that they are in a better place, a glorious place, a matchless place, a marvelous place, in the name of Jesus in heaven. Touch us, oh God. Touch our pastor, oh Lord. Touch him to pastor this congregation. Touch him when he's about to preach God's word. Touch the world that we live in. Touch racism, oh Lord, that there's no more racism. There's no more classism. There's no more sexism. There's no more ism. Touch the people in Israel, oh God. Touch the Israel and the Palestinian in Gaza that's fighting an unjust war. Touch the people that have lost their lives, and touch them, oh God, that they have lost. Touch, oh Jesus. Touch, oh God, this world which we live in. Touch the president. Touch the Senate. Touch the city of Detroit, oh God. Touch the governor. Touch everybody here that we need a miracle, that we need a breakthrough, that we need deliverance, oh God. Just touch today. Set us free from any type of captivity. Set us free from the devil. Set us free from Satan. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, as we pray, amen and amen and amen to you.
Easter presentation. I'm looking for a Reverend JB. Okay.
Amen, amen. He is risen. Oh, wait, I can't hear you. He is risen. One more time. I'm about to take this with me. He is risen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He is risen indeed. Yes, God. My Lord, my Lord. Now, as much as I would love to stay before you and dance, sing, and shout, we have young ones that have practiced long and hard for our Easter program. So as they come out, you see we got our teenagers setting up. This is a family affair. Can we welcome them in royal Hartford fashion with a round of applause? Amen, amen. And we will be blessed in just a moment by our 2024 Easter presentation, written by Sister Jasmine Crawford. Yeah, amen. A child of Hartford. Come on, y'all. Raise them up. Raise them up. Raise them up. And they shall not depart. The name of this year's Easter play is Make Disciples. All right. And now here come the little ones. We've got everybody here this morning. Good morning, good morning. We've got our teens, we've got our little ones, and we've got our middles. So today is a special day, very special. Can someone tell me, on the count of three, why is today special? One, two, three.
It's Easter Sunday.
Yes, it is Easter Sunday. And what makes Easter Sunday special? Yes, it's when Jesus came back from the dead. Amen, amen. But wait, Easter, that's about a bunny, isn't it? It's about a bunny and candy, right?
No.
No, okay. Yes and no, I agree. It is more about Jesus coming back from the dead than it is about candy and bunnies. Amen. But you know what? There was someone else that was brought back from the dead. Let's see if one of our teens knows this. Who did Jesus bring back from the dead? Sydney?
Lazarus.
Lazarus, yes. What else do you guys know about Lazarus? Go ahead, pass that mic around. Jordan?
Martha didn't want Jesus to go to the tomb because it was 4 days after Lazarus had died and she thought it would smell bad.
Very true, very true. What else, Aaron?
Lazarus was ill, and Jesus had risen back from the dead 4 days later.
Amen, amen. And what else, Cam?
Lazarus was the brother of Martha and Mary.
Very good. And I think there's one other thing. We've got London and Asar. What do you guys remember?
Jesus wept.
Exactly. Can't forget that. The thing I want all of us to remember about Lazarus is that Jesus bringing Lazarus back from the dead made people so angry that they wanted to kill Jesus. Okay? Well, you know what? There's so much that I could say, but I think that maybe we can show everybody better than we can tell them, okay? So let's play it out. Let's play it out. Can I have a couple of strong soldiers? All right, check. Can I have a teacher, a preacher, and a judge? Beautiful, beautiful. All right. You know, can I have some friends for Jesus? Jesus had friends. All right. And we cannot talk about the day of resurrection without Jesus. I need somebody to play Jesus.
I can do it.
Are you sure? It's a big job and it has some really hard parts.
I know. I think I can handle it.
All right, perfect.
All right, now that everybody's in place, show us what happened, y'all, when Jesus was arrested.
Who are you looking for?
Jesus of Nazareth.
I am he.
We are looking for Jesus of Nazareth. Show yourself.
I said, I am he.
No,
not my friend.
No, let them take me.
But Jesus, why will you let them?
God gave me this cup, might as well drink from it.
We have orders to take you to the judge tonight.
Tonight is too dark.
Those are the orders.
Your Honor, we bring before you Jesus of Nazareth and present him for execution.
Execution? What are your crimes?
I have taught in the streets and in the synagogues. My teachings have been heard because I am not hiding. If I have done anything evil or untrue, tell me. But if not, why are you trying to persecute me? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I thirst.
Look, he's calling Elijah.
Try get yourself out of this, King of the Jews.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
Ooh, you guys, how do you think Jesus' followers felt once they took him away?
Sad.
Yep, everybody was so sad they cried and mourned for how many days?
Three days
straight. But on the third day, Mary, Jesus' mother, and Mary, Jesus' friend, decided that they wanted to bless Jesus' tomb. They wanted to anoint his body with incense and oils and change his clothes.
Mary, we have to go bless Jesus' body.
Okay, let's go, but who's gonna open his tomb?
I don't know. We have to try, though.
Fear not. I know you seek Jesus who was crucified, but he is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see for yourself. Now, go and tell everyone what you have seen. Jesus has risen and waits for you in Galilee. Family, friends, go forth and make disciples out of everyone, all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go on and teach what I have commanded you. I will be with you as you do this. I will be with you always.
Very good, you guys.
All right.
All right, hands up, one more time. Okay, come on, you guys.
Amen. What a wonderful rendition from the children. Let's give them another hand. Certainly, we want to thank Reverend JB and our sister Jasmine. Amen. For that hard work. That's our future. So, one thing for sure, we can rest. Be rest assured that they know Jesus is alive. Amen. And now we will have our church announcements. Oh, you got something else to say? Go on.
I could. I just want to let all of our little ones know that we are having teen church and youth church right now. So if you guys want to come on downstairs, we can start building our Easter baskets, okay? God bless you. Thank you so much, Media Ministry.
Greetings, Hartford. My name is Joyce Young, and these are your announcements.
Attention, Hartford members and friends. The Rackham Choir presents, in collaboration with Wayne State University Department of Music, Duke Ellington Sacred Concert on April 14th at 5:30 p.m. right here at Hartford Memorial Baptist Church. Tickets are available on Eventbrite.
The Meyer Spring Simply Give campaign for Hartford's Food Pantry begins March 31 and runs through June 29. Our Meyer store is located at 1301 West 8 Mile, Detroit, Michigan. Please get a $10 Simply Give donation card from the Church Guard Station or the Hartford Bookstore, or pick them up at the store. Just specify that you want the card for Hartford. Take the cards to our Meyer store and give them $10. This donation will be converted into a Meyer Food Only gift card given to Hartford. Our double match day is Saturday, June 15, effectively tripling contributions on that day. The sole purpose for Meyer's Simply Give program is to help our food pantry feed the growing number of hungry families in our community. Since the beginning of 2024, we have served over 2,000 families. Food insecurity continues to be on the rise in the community, which makes our commitment to the cause vital. We look forward to your support.
Remember to connect with us on social media so you stay connected with all that's happening in and around Hartford Church. Now, we turn the service back over to the pulpit.
I have an additional announcement on page 10 of your bulletin. You will find that Hartford's Business Ministry is inviting everyone to its financial literacy workshop Sunday, April 14th in the Fellowship Hall during breakfast from 9:30 to 10:45. The speaker is financial professional and author Gail Perry Mason. She has financial literacy information for all ages and generations. For more information, contact our business ministry members listed on page 14 of your bulletin, as well as the Hartford Business Ministry President, Deacon John Bradley. Hope to see you there. And now, it is time where we all can participate. It's offering time. So you can't be God-given, amen? Whether it's Easter Sunday or any Sunday, because he's been better to us than we've been to ourselves. When I look in this sanctuary, I see all the finery that God has provided. And I thank God that physically he's made a way out of no way that you've been able to come and fellowship with us today. So as the trustees and the ushers prepare the service, as well as the music ministry, we invite you to give. Hartford is one of the most giving churches in our community. You can use our giving platforms or bring your offering to 18900 James Cousins Freeway in Detroit, 48235, from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Or you can use our giving platforms, Givelify, Cash App, $HMBC, 18900, and you can put it in the tray today. Amen. Please give. God loves a cheerful giver. And now our choir. I'm sorry, I guess we need to do our offertory sentences while we're waiting. All right. Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over will be put into your lap. For the measure you give will be the measure you get back. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust can consume and where thieves can break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures on earth. Altogether, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Amen. Let us pray. Hallelujah, God, we give you thanks and praise for every gift and for every giver. We pray, oh God, a special prayer for the person who had a desire to give but had not. Let us be mindful to use these gifts for the furthering and upbuilding of your kingdom here on earth, that it might make a difference in our community, in our city, our state, and our nation. We'll be careful to give you praise and thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. Won't we give our musicians another hand? Julian Good on the organ. Amani Henry, amen, on the other organ, amen. Felicia Hill, our sister, Dr. Sylvia Hollifield, and certainly we're thankful for this amazing choir, amen. God is a good God. Please remain standing for our priest sermon hymn, He Lives.
Thank you. Jesus. For all that eyes have seen, all that our ears have heard, and all that our hearts have felt. To all those who gather in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to all those who serve and sacrifice regularly, for those who are here just on one of those sacred days, what is that, Mother's Day? CME, that's right. Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter. God bless you. Amen. Thank you all for lifting us up this morning in the liturgy, in the prayer, in the praise. Has not our hearts burned within us at the sound of this choir? Woo. I just appreciated every bit of the journey, the runway, and then the takeoff have been a blessing. So thank you so much. I want to turn our attention to Romans, the 10th chapter, starting at verse 9, ending at verse 10. And let us read those two verses together. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. One believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Two-factor salvation. Two-factor salvation. Amen. Two-factor identification is pretty easy, right? Easy breezy, lemon squeezy. I ain't get no amen on that. But isn't it funny that religious people are always adding these prerequisites to salvation, when Paul only gives us these two? Some say you have to speak in tongues. Some say you must know the Baptist distinctives. You must understand the Catholic or Protestant catechisms, which are manuals, to really claim soul salvation. Perhaps we should memorize the Nicene or Apostles' Creed. Have you memorized the church covenant? It ain't that we're gonna live by it. It's not like we're gonna act like it's real, but we feel like if we just chant it often enough, somehow it is enough for salvation. Now, while these things may increase your experience, understanding, and fellowship in church, Paul does not list them as prerequisites for salvation. But thanks be to God for Easter that have brought us back to the core of our beliefs. We make faith a big challenge. We make it a barrier. We make it a tremendous hurdle to jump. But Paul is here to remind us that Easter and salvation is easier than we think. You ain't got to add anything to it. You don't have to take anything away from it. Do what Paul says and you shall be saved. Yeah, I like this translation because it had a period at the end of it. Matter of fact, most of the translation had periods at the end of it, meaning that's it. That's the end of the thought. You don't have to add anything more. But even the American Standard Version and the Basic English Version, they use a colon at the end of it, which also means that the thought is complete. The colon is after the introduction of a thought. It's the period stacked on another period, and it means that anything after that is just commentary on that which preceded it. It will carry over and continue the discussion from that subject before the colon. You don't hear me. It ain't a semicolon with the comma and the period stacked on top of it, meaning that you have two independent phrases or clauses that are often put together by a conjunction. And it could be one started out one thing and ended up another, could be two independent thoughts, could be one thought more is required. No, what Paul is saying and the translators are translating is that when Jesus says that you are saved, you are saved. When you do what Jesus told us to do, we are saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. We are saved. That means that our deliverance is sure. That means our healing is done. That means our blessings are at hand. When you are saved, it is done in Jesus' name. Anybody know that they're saved today? Anybody know that they know that they're saved today? Anybody know that they know that they know that they're saved today? I said, anybody know that they 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 are saved? Yeah, see, everybody couldn't shout because everybody doesn't know. They just don't want you to know. But don't worry about it, because Paul said it's easier than you think. First, all you have to do is confess with your mouth. Amen? That Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead. Yes, because like Mike used to sing, he learned that love needs expression. Amen. Yeah. If you love somebody, you got to say it every now and then. Don't act like you can't get it out. Don't mumble it. Well, I love you, baby. Don't be afraid to tell it. One of the five love languages, matter of fact, the first of the five love languages that are written in the book, the five love languages, isn't that words of affirmation? Yeah, that's number one. That's number one. And what it means is that sometimes the words get in the way and we have to practice expressing and confessing our love. Matter of fact, Jesus really kind of doubled down on this. And in every synoptic gospel, he warns us that if we deny him before others, then he will deny us before his Father in heaven. Yeah, I like the way Matthew put it. If anyone is ashamed of me, he said, and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will also be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. Hallelujah. And Paul reiterated the message time and time again. If we deny him, he will deny us. But how would you like it if somebody denied you? If somebody wouldn't say, I love you publicly? You know, when me and my honey got together, I said, baby, we got to keep this on the low. I don't want to be the center of attention. She said, the devil is a liar. Confess it, brother. I said, okay. I had enough sense to say, okay. And I've been happy ever since, Doc. Best thing I ever did. There was a sermon by a man named Hartford E. Luckock. Hartford E. Luckock, classic preacher, kind of on the lines of a Charles Spurgeon or so. And he wrote a beautiful sermon based on Peter's denial of Jesus Christ. And it was called Ashamed of Our Best. Ashamed of Our Best. You know, we need to really understand that sometimes we are ashamed to admit that we believe in Jesus Christ, that we depend on God, You don't want to be ostracized. You don't want to be misunderstood. You don't want people to think that you are some type of fanatic. But you will not receive every blessing that God has for you unless you claim Him and are unafraid to be a witness for the Lord. Amen. We don't want it to appear that we are His disciples, and I'll tell you why. Because unconsciously, it's not just people pleasing, but we want to have an out. We want to have an escape clause. We want to have a way that we can drop out of what God wants us to do and be, and nobody really give us any hassle about it, because we never really took a stand to begin with. Psychologists will tell you that if you want to live a healthy lifestyle, if you want to improve your life, if you want to make a real resolution, you ought to confess it before others, right? See, I got to confess to you that I want to lose weight, that I'm going to lose weight, that I'm determined to lose weight. So when you see me sitting up in Kentucky Fried Chicken, waiting in line at Popeyes, you can say, Reverend, get out of there. You said you wanted to lose weight. It's accountability, Doc. You know, there was a family that hung an American flag outside of their house. They lived on a lonely road. There were very few people that passed by this little farm. They had a rare visitor, and that visitor looked at that American flag waving in the wind and said, "Why do you have that flag sitting on your porch? You know nobody sees it, nobody passes by your house. Why do you have that flag up on your porch?" They said, "We can see it. We look at it. We're reminded of ourselves. We're reminded of what we believe. We're reminded of what we stand for. We hold ourselves accountable. And when we confess the Lord, we hold ourselves accountable to our own belief." This is a principle that will bless all of our lives. Could you imagine a patriot who has not memorized the Pledge of Allegiance? Could you imagine a Boy Scout that didn't know their oath, motto, slogan, and code? Could you imagine some Girl Scout that didn't know their promises? No, honey, they know them. Amen. Could you imagine a brother who went to Morehouse that does not know how to sing "Dear Old Morehouse"? I'm here to tell you, it does not happen. That's the first thing you learn before you learn anything else. "Dear Old Morehouse." You know, James Brown said in April of 1968 that he was shocked, just like the rest of the world, when Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. But he said he was even more shocked in the aftermath when he looked around and he saw that while we should have been working together for a better day in the black community, there was a lot of infighting, there was a lot of strife, there was a lot of division, there was a lot of crime. He said, "You know what? We have lost our pride." That's when he went to his hotel room and started writing the lyrics to "Say It Loud." Amen. And by August of that same year, "Say It Loud" became the anthem of the civil rights movement. So much so that it was number one on the R&B charts for 6 weeks, and it rose to number 10 on the Billboard Top 100. Black folk, after they started saying it loud, started walking different, dressing different, wearing their hair different, started celebrating holidays like Kwanzaa that had been started 2 years before, because they confessed with their mouth, because they could say, "Say it loud, say it loud. I'm black and I'm proud." Somebody say, "Say it loud, say it loud. There's There's a reason why they didn't want you to say Black Lives Matter. There's a reason why they kept on talking about All Lives Matter. There's a reason why they didn't want you to claim it for yourself. Because if we start talking it, then we may start walking it. If we start saying it, we may start acting like it. If you don't see it, you can't be it. But I don't know about you. I am unashamedly Christian and unashamedly Black and unapologetically Christian, and I'll say it loud. What on earth are we ashamed of? Now, we weren't ashamed when we were doing everything that we were big and bad enough to do. What are we embarrassed about? We weren't embarrassed to go up into some of those clubs, houses, dives, and holes we went in. We weren't ashamed of our actions, attitudes, and behaviors when we were walking around telling people we could live without God. Arrogant, rude, stiff-necked, hard-hearted, hard-headed, as my grandmother used to say, and we weren't ashamed of that. Now you're gonna tell me you ashamed to believe in the resurrection? You ashamed to tell people that love never dies? You telling me that you ashamed to believe in life is forever? You mean you are ashamed to believe that God can do anything but fail? You mean you ashamed to say that God can do exceedingly and abundantly above anything you could ask or imagine? No, honey, let me tell you something. The resurrection is the most sane, rational, beautiful, logical, reasonable thing that we could ever confess. Paul opened up Romans with this theme so that we could get it through our thick heads. I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone that believes. I'm not ashamed of Jesus Christ. And Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. That's a good segue to where I leave you. Because the second thing that Paul tells us is that not only should we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, but the second factor of our salvation is believing it in our heart. Hallelujah. Yeah, we got to believe it in our heart. Amen. We've got to understand that it's more than talking about it. It's a matter of the heart. It's more than an intellectual problem. It's a matter of the heart. Obedience, trust, and love are issues of the heart. Whether God is three persons in one or two natures in one person is really an intellectual concern, but this is something that we've got to feel in our hearts. You see, the problem with our confessions are that we are not saying enough. We could not say enough. The problem is not in what we say. The problem is in what we don't say, what we can't say. Our words are not enough. Our words are incomplete. Our words are insufficient. How can we contain the totality of God in a simple phrase? How can we contain the eternal nature of God in a few words? It's like P.A. used to say, it's like trying to put an ocean in a teacup. You can't do it. You can't contain it. Oh, but the heart. The heart is big enough. Oh, but the heart. The heart is limitless in its capacity. My words may not be enough. My mind may not be enough. My creed deeds may not be enough, but my heart is so big. Somebody ought to say, you don't know what God means to me. You don't know, like Dr. Johnson used to say, the cost of my praise. I could stay here all day long, but you never really understand what God means to me. Hallelujah. I thank you, Lord, that my heart is big enough to contain God, but my words are not enough. You know, when I'm in love, when I'm shown enough in love, I ain't got to be hanging all over my loved one all the time. I ain't got to wear it on my sleeve. I don't have to do a lot of the things to show people that I'm in love. Hallelujah. But our actions will start speaking when our words run out. What about those five languages? After the words of affirmation come acts of service, receiving of gifts, quality time, physical touch. Somebody knows that when you're in love, the talking only goes so far. Somebody knows that when you're in love, you can talk all you want, but sometimes the talking is over. It's time for the talking to cease. When somebody doing a whole lot of talking, get ready, because ain't nothing happening. They're talking, amen. But I thank you, Lord, that when real love comes in, it's time to get to it. It's time to be about it. Amen. When Jesus said, when you want to understand the love of God, he said, whoever has my commands and keep them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father. And I too will love them and show myself to them. Watch this. This is a lesson that we have to do something to claim the love of God. We have to move in some way. It has to be deeper than our words. It has to be deeper than our confessions. Now, I'll tell you, nobody really likes two-factor identification. I used it as a metaphor, but I almost did it tongue-in-cheek. Nobody likes two-factor identification. Why? Because it's hard enough to remember one password, right? But now you got to remember two. It's hard enough to manage one device, but now you got to be on the computer and then open up your cell phone. You got two devices trying to grant entry into the information that you need, and nobody likes it. But hallelujah, what makes it easy? I'll tell you what makes it easy. What makes it easy is the pieces of evidence that we need to get in are personal. It's a personal address. It's a personal date. It's a personal ID. It's a personal relationship. It is a personal thing that you can remember that will give you the ability to remember your passwords. And your passwords will give you entry. It's a personal thing. And how many of you know that religion is personal? Proverbs 4:23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything flows from it. This is personal. And when God is in my heart, I believe in the innermost parts of my soul that everything that flows from it will be of God. I said, when God is in my heart, when I meditate upon his word, when I meditate upon his law, day and night, what flows from my heart is an anxiety and stress reliever. What flows from my heart is a painkiller. What flows from my heart is great power. Sin can't hold me down. I'm an overcomer when I've got God in my heart. I become self-aware. I become self-empowered. I become self-motivated. When God is in my heart, I said, is he in your heart today? It'll help you. It'll help you love others. Jesus said, a new commandment I give to you. Love one another as I have loved you. So you also must love one another. By your love for one another, they will know that you're my disciples. Not by your creeds, not by your confessions, but your love for one another. Somebody say, what is this? I can feel it deep inside. What is this? And it's setting my soul on fire. Whatever it is, it won't let me hold my peace. Yeah, but it makes me love my enemies. It makes me love my friends. It won't let me be ashamed to say that I've been born again. Hallelujah. Somebody say, there is a name. I love to sing. I love to sing its worth. It's the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. I'm not too big. I'm not too old. I'm not too proud to say I love Jesus. Somebody ought to say, Jesus is all the world to me. My life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him, I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go. No other love can keep me so. Jesus is all the world to me. Somebody say, Jesus is my captain. Somebody else say, Jesus is my friend. Somebody ought to say, Jesus brought me from a long ways back. Jesus, there it is. You know, we had a young student who graduated from Andover High School in Massachusetts, the Andover. I said this young brother was one of ours. He lived on the east side of Detroit. He had quite a story. His mother and father were in the streets. He had to raise himself for a portion of his life. But he was so gifted, so talented, so unique, so rare, that he went from the east side to Andover. I'm talking about the Andover. The Andover where the Bushes send their children. The Andover. The Andover where the Kennedys study. The Andover where the Rockefellers and Mellons send generation after generation. Hallelujah. This young brother goes to Andover on a full scholarship, but his aunt brought him in to me and she said, Kristen, just rap with him for a while because he's at Andover telling people that he grew up in Southfield. He's at Andover telling people that he came from a stable household. He's at Andover telling people that everything was all right, and that's what got him here, was his privilege. That's what got him here, his prosperity. And I rapped with the brother, and to my surprise, when he graduated from Andover, he went to Morehouse College with all the options that were available to him. He went to the house, and it was at the house that they taught him a deeper love, a love of his own culture, a love of the greatness of his people, a love of the brilliance that God placed in him, a love of the journey that got him to where he was. And when he graduated from Morehouse College and he sat at the table with the heads of industry, kings and queens, powerful presidents, he told them, hallelujah, he told them that my journey wasn't easy. He told them that I had a rough way to go. He told them that I don't look like what I've been through. If it wasn't for God, I don't think I could have made it. If it wasn't for God, I don't think I'd be here right now. If it wasn't for the Lord, I don't think that I'd be the man that I am today. But I thank God for my auntie who blessed me when others failed me. I thank God for my community that embraced me when I didn't think I could go out. I thank God for my mountains. I thank God for my valleys. I thank God for the storms that he brought me through. He brought me from the east side. He brought me from a long ways back. He brought me from down and lifted me up. He brought me from out and brought me in. He's all the world to me. Thank you, Lord. I'll tell the world I didn't make it on my own. God made all the difference. I may be dressed in white, but it was God that made a way. I'm proud of my journey. God taught me how to love. God taught me devotion. God taught me perseverance. God gave me patience. I was broken. God fixed me. I was lost. God found me. I was sick. God healed me. I was bound. God freed me. I was down. God raised me. I was a sinner. God saved me. Can I get a witness? Thank you, Lord. Thank you for Easter. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for salvation. I'll never shall forget what you've done for me. I'll confess it with my mouth. I believe it in my heart. And I pray that somebody will do likewise. Would you confess with your mouth as we open up the doors of the church and believe in your heart that our God loves you? I like that. That he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, that whosoever believeth on him would not perish. One more time. God so loved the world. God so loved the world that he gave. That he gave his means you. That means when you're up, that means when you're down. All hail. Would not perish. Should not perish. Could not perish. Not perish. Thank you that we will never be led astray by those that come up with strange doctrines. We know, oh God, what we need to do. We will confess with our mouth. We will believe in our heart. And then we will leave it to others to draw their own conclusion. We will leave it to this world to do what this world does. But we'll know, oh God, that we are claimed by you eternally through Jesus Christ our Lord. And it is in his name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Save us. You might be seated momentarily. We're just going to center down for 30 seconds before we leave here. I want to thank the choir for singing today, for singing Good Friday. You know, here's the funny thing. This year, you know, we didn't have the storm in the music, you know, where they turn off the lights and, you know, right? And but Sherry Berry came in and was the storm on that song. Amen. We're gonna revisit that, but I thank God. Excuse me. I thank God for the storm that was this choir, and they hosted Christ Church Cranbrook of Bloomfield Hills so hospitably, so kind and graciously. We changed some of our protocols, and they only asked that we just work in some of their music, and they wanted to hear a little gospel and different things like that. And they said, well, you know, we sing in Latin often, And our choir said, "Is that all?" We got that. We thought you were going to say something difficult. We got that. And they did it all. Latin, Du Bois, they did it all. Felicia was thumping. I saw one man shouting against his own will. Looked like he wanted to hold it in. Think he went out to the narthex and started shouting. But I want to thank everybody who preached Holy Week. Minister Natalie Cherry preached a wonderful sermon. The cell group leaders, you know, the church started in homes. You know, it started in people's houses. And then it spread. And then we started creating these gilded and cloistered hallways. But I thank God for all those who taught in homes. Some groups were just 3 and 4 people. Some had 17, 20, 30 people. Amen. But they were all heartfelt and sincere. And they spoke on Tuesday. Wednesday, the Reverend V. Lonnie Peake did his thing. We learned things about him that we didn't know. He said that, what was your name? Wasn't always Vassy. That's your first name. That's the V. Yeah, but let me tell you, you can talk to him about that. But he preached about the purpose of God, and it was a blessing. Stuck with me throughout the week. Next night, he was still with me when we went to Tabernacle. And let me tell you, Hartford showed up at Tabernacle and showed out. I've never seen that many people at Tab from Hartford. And you really did it. You really did it. They were greatly encouraged by your presence, by your gift, by your service, by your sacrifice to be there. All I can say is thank you. Saturday, Reverend Lionel Scott preached the Easter Vigil. Reverend Lionel Scott preached the last watch before Easter Sunday. And I should also verbally say thank you to Pastor Manisha Dostert from Christ Church Cranbrook, who preached first word. Reverend Jonathan, that preached the second word very creatively. Reverend Dr. Bill Danaher, wonderful man, who preached a wonderful sermon for the fourth. The fifth word came from the Reverend Dr. Ramona Chapman, blew us away. The sixth word came from the honorable, the distinguished Dr. Shannon Holmes, not only the First Lady of Renaissance Baptist Church. Oh, wait, did I forget? Dr. Kenneth Flowers, who confessed on, y'all have to see the tape, about a little Colt 45 and some strawberry wine, and it didn't end well. As you could imagine, not that you've ever tried it, it did not end well. But his sermon did, and it was wonderful. And Dr. Shannon, then she preached, blew us out of the water, and then it was downhill all the way because the job was done and all we had to do was just claim the blessing that God gave us. And then here we are from 6 in the morning till now, and it's been a blessing. I ain't tired yet. And I know that you have things to do. Thank you for the children. It's 12:48, and we had the children's pageant program and everything. So thank you to all who have been here since early in the morning. I won't keep you another second. You can look in the bulletin. Our food pantry is honored. We have some great programs and activities coming. Don't you miss the Rackham Choir. We're going to have that stage like we did with Samara Joy. Don't miss, we have a sister coming in who's going to do a workshop in cooperation with American Baptist Churches. We got so much happening. Don't miss anything. All rise. Let us get ready to leave this place. Thank you to the food pantry. The 75 or so volunteers will be honored in Lansing on Wednesday, April the 10th. The governor is going to honor us amongst 168 Forgotten Harvest food sites. We are being lifted up as one of the best out of 168. Amen. And remember in that announcement, it said since January, we've served over 2,000 families with an average size of 4 to 5 people per family. So that's a lot of food. And we thank the Lord that our religion has feet. Amen. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives. We're going to have a church meeting on the 11th. It's gone. Because I know if you're in leadership, bring a report. We'll see you on the 9th. And life is worth the living just because he lived. Somebody left their keys in the bathroom. You're not going very far. So if you don't feel around, if you don't feel your keys, check at the pulpit. And now unto God, who is able to keep us from falling, present us faultless before the presence of his glory, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let everybody who believes, everybody who's not ashamed to confess it, say amen. Hallelujah. So let it be. Easter baskets downstairs for the kids. If you reserved the Easter lily, you may take them. After everybody who has taken them, who reserved them, we have extras that you may take. But just give us about 10 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes before you grab the extras. So just fellowship with one another. Then you can grab the extra Easter lilies and take them all home. They're